It's the Playhouse Podcast with Kat and JJ.
Believe it. I missed everything.
Missed the show.
What am I going to do?
Check out the Daily Podcast.
So how do you deal with a husband or a wife that isn't really kind of pulling their weight around the house? Is it something a little bit deeper, or are they just being lazy? You got to dig into our OPP with us a little bit later on in the podcast. Here we go.
Bingo. How fun.
Last week, someone lost an eye at bingo.
Bingo.
Bingo, what bingo?
Bingo.
Bingo. First caller through, we want to hear your story, but only the first person, and you got to fit one of the following two criteria. Maybe you're somebody listening who...
who has dated someone, but you found out things about them later on that you're like, wow, I really dodged a bullet. They have a movie scene. Okay, so Anna Kendrick is in the new Woman of the Hour, and they have like a dating game scene. And then they have this real audio of the dating game, the episode where the serial killer, Rodney, was it Alcala, was on it.
I just remember seeing clips of it.
This is the clip here.
Bachelor number one, what's your best time?
The best time is at night, nighttime.
Why do you say that?
Because that's the only time there is.
What's wrong with the morning, afternoon?
Well, they're okay, but nighttime's when it really gets good.
Hard to fillet a human during the day.
It really is. Yeah, the light really ruins.
Yeah, this guy was an actual, ended up being a killer, and the dating game. Lots of rumors around that whole thing. I mean, it seemed like an innocent enough deal, but yeah.
They were like, you really dodged a bullet. You could have been dating a serial killer. So someone you dated, you found out something about them later on, and you were like, wow, that could have been bad. Like,
they were the nicest, prettiest girl, and then I found out she was a member of the Nazi party.
Right.
You know, stuff like that. I'm looking for anyone listening who, oh, they got the video up right now, who has a super dangerous job. Cops had to climb this radio tower in Eagan to rescue one of the radio maintenance guys. He got stuck up there, couldn't get down, had a panic attack, and obviously climbing 1,000 feet on a radio tower is a pretty dangerous job.
Those guys, things sway, you know, that would be very nerve-wracking.
They're kind of tied down into giant concrete blocks under the ground, but they do sway at the very top. I've had the opportunity to go 100 feet up and not 1,000 where our stick is. And that was it. I'm like, I'm coming down. This is dangerous.
Do you think he was Snapchatting photos?
Probably. Those guys go up there with those sticks and they do all sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
Good morning, Jessica. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good.
Great. We're great, too. Thanks for asking. So you dodged a bullet. Is this the one you're calling about?
Yes.
Please do tell.
It wasn't me. It was my sister.
Oh, okay.
My sister was 16. She dated this guy for 2 years. And he started getting, like, physically abusive with her.
Uh-huh.
And she finally broke up with him, and then 5 years later, he killed someone and buried his body on his property.
Oh, my God. How did you guys find that out? Was it one of those you were just watching the news one day, and there his face was?
Yep, and then he was on America's Most Wanted.
No!
So he murdered, buried the body, and then was on the run.
Yep.
And they finally caught up with this guy, I'm assuming? Okay.
Oh, your phone is terrible.
So, jeez.
That is time.
Okay, so he's in prison, I'm going to guess, for the rest of his life now.
I think so. I don't know. I'm 100% sure.
Whoa, hold on. This guy was this close to your family, killed a guy, buried his body, and you don't know where he is at this very second? I would absolutely know where this guy was every second of my life.
Yeah.
Did he seem like a pretty decent dude, like, up until the physical abuse started?
He was always decent towards me.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's how they get you. They want, like, friends and family to be on their side so then they can make the person that they're abusing look crazy. So
I'm not a violent person, but if I ever find out that someone's hitting a girl, then that's where, I mean, especially if it was my daughter, my wife, my sister, something like that, then it's all hands on deck. I mean, it's going to go down. I'll go to jail for that.
Yep.
Something
we found out about it, quite a few people flipped out.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, really dodged a bullet there. And your sister's doing okay now with this?
Yeah, she married a multimillionaire.
Oh, well, good turnabout, huh? Fun Christmases.
What
all right.
Say, money
thanks,
makes
Jessica.
Everything
appreciate
better.
It. No, until you're dead, right?
Right.
That's crazy. I mean, she could have ended up, let's say this guy wasn't abusing her and she thought he was Mr. Right. Because when you're 16, yeah, thanks, Jessica. I appreciate your thoughts this morning. When you're 16, you think that guy is probably the rest of your life kind of guy.
So I'm wondering if you have somebody in jail that you are nervous if they were to get out, can you get on a list of people that they have to contact? Because there are a lot of cases when some people find out like 2 months after this person gets out. Oh, yeah, they got out 60 days ago, you know.
Oh, so you were in a relationship with them, and maybe that was a month later they broke up. They did something really heinous.
Or you helped put them away. You know, you're sleeping well at night knowing exactly where they're at, and then all of a sudden you find out that they're not there anymore. I wonder. That'd be very nerve-wracking, too.
Just even knowing that my sister's ex-boyfriend was a murderer is too close. Can I tell you real quick before I get to my gift?
Yeah.
I had the weirdest, most profound dream in the history of the world last night.
Our dreams, are they connected? You say yours.
Okay.
And then if it connects to mine, I'll say.
So, yesterday, I leave work. I get in an amazing workout. Like, it was one of those days where I took too much pre-workout and I couldn't really harness myself.
Yeah.
And I was great chest workout, hit the treadmill pretty hard, great sweat. But what happened on my last set? So this is, long story short, years and years and years ago, I had cracked a few ribs.
Yeah.
Sure. And every once in a while, about every 5 years, I'll do something stupid and I'll pop a rib out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in the short ribs in the back that I popped a rib out yesterday. I could feel it on my way home as I was breathing, right? So go about my day yesterday, make hamburgers for the family, get them in the fridge, go to football practice. Everything's fine. Still hard to breathe. And I knew I just kind of had to pop it back in.
What a champ.
I go to bed last night. I had a dream that my deceased father was with me, took me, bent me over, and popped my rib back in.
No way.
Woke up this morning, zero pain, no breathing issues whatsoever. I've been struggling with this all
You don't believe this stuff, though.
Morning. I'm not saying I don't believe in it.
Well, your face says otherwise.
It was very, very odd.
Yeah.
And I have zero pain now. It doesn't even feel like, usually there's a couple of days of residual pain when it pops back in because you got all these ligaments and tendons and stuff that are messed up. But it feels amazing. I was wigged out. I didn't realize that I felt well until I was walking out to my truck this morning, and my wife probably has it on her ring cam. I stopped and it was just like, there's no pain. And it was the most vivid memory. I mean, it was so crystal clear. And it was so weird because I didn't imagine my dad, like when he was sick at the end of his life or even when he got a little older, it was like his like 40-year-old self.
Yeah.
You know, like those really
the
deep memories
version.
You have. Yeah, yeah, that was crazy. Okay, tell me about your dream.
Well, bless up Gary.
Yeah, what's up?
I guarantee.
What's up, G?
Oh, no, mine doesn't.
His socks compared to that.
I was like blowing like huge marbles out of my nose and cracking people in the face with it. So, yeah, no, yours is definitely more meaningful. So, congratulations.
We're looking for great burns this week. Got to be air appropriate. But if you want to get a little mean, that's fine. You know, we're all loving in here.
Mean, but like appropriate.
Got it. And it's Makayla, not Makayla, right?
Yep.
Makayla.
How old
right.
are you, Makayla?
I'm 19.
All right. I like this. Let's get to the Yelcher show. So Dave is also going to compete this morning. What do you got going on, Dave?
No, I'm just getting off of work.
All right.
You going to feel good, Dave, saying something like this to a 19-year-old girl?
He doesn't know her. He can feel fine about it.
All right.
All right. So I always ladies first on the show. So, Makayla, we need your best burn whenever you're ready.
Okay. Your mom was so fat, when God said, let there be light, he asked her to move out of the way.
What?
Makayla with a burn.
Bringing the heat. All right, Dave, it's a tall order, but you got to have a better burn. You're up.
Oh, no.
Dave, you didn't know what we were doing here today, did you?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, okay, go ahead then.
Your mother's so ugly, Freddy Krueger gets nightmares over.
Your mother.
Okay, right. Those are our two burns. Now you guys hang on the line. What we're going to do is we're going to let our audience decide. If you could see Kat's face, guys. We're going to let our audience decide on who gets the Usher tickets. So Makayla had the first burn. Dave had the second burn. Sometimes when you do a radio contest, it's a contest.
You don't know who's going to win.
Sometimes you do a radio contest
and it's a landslide.
Makea, you're going to see Usher.
Good job, Makea. I think we all knew. I think even number two knew.
What are you doing right now, Makea? It sounds like you got a whole bunch of people around you.
I do daycare, so I have little kids running around.
So just neglect some children, win some concert tickets. That's what your day is.
Do you know any Usher songs that you're going to hear?
Yeah, I should.
Okay.
I know the Burn one and...
Oh.
All right, great. Cool. This is a high-end bit. We'll definitely go into the podcast. So hang on. You're going to see Usher on the 3rd. Congratulations, Makea.
Yes.
This is the part where you go, thank you, guys. So, Makea, this is the part where you go, thank you, and then we can move on.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Guys with belly button rings. First thoughts on that? We'll tell you why we're talking about it at 7:05 during our live show Wednesday morning at 8:20. We've got more tickets to see Usher live in concert. So lots going on Wednesday on the live show. Right now, let's finish up the podcast. OPP is other people's problems. We got a little text message thing going with a lot of people, some DMs. People just call the show and they've got things going on in their lives. And number one, we can always keep you anonymous if you want. We can throw you on voice change. But a lot of people just have questions that are kind of things that are going on in all of our lives at one point or another. So we'd like to throw them out on the radio and help you out. Grateful for Sean. Saw his text, and I'm glad that he picked up this morning. You want to tell everybody kind of what's going on at home?
So, like, wife and I, you know, have been married 8 years.
Okay.
Have 3 kids between us.
Oh.
And, you know, it's just, you know, beginning was great. You know, we split chores and everything. But now it's just kind of, it's just me doing everything, like all the chores, cooking, all mm-hmm. that stuff.
What's her reasoning for not helping, or do you guys discuss that a lot?
I mean, like, she just says, you know, she gets tired and forgets, but, you know, if you're, you know, it's like right before bed, you know, we put the kids to bed, you know, I just, you know, if there's some dirty dishes in the sink, you know, at least throw them in the dishwasher, you know,
right.
But she just kind of leaves them out and just leaves a mess.
Yeah. Well, I think obviously a marriage is a partnership. So how have you tried to talk to her about this? Does she deal with depression at all? Like, could this be it?
No, I mean, she's generally, you know, happy. She has her little mom groups that she's a part of. It's just, but, you know, just when she gets home, just everything drops.
Yeah.
Just everything drops off. Like, I've kind of tell you, like, how, you know, I'm just, I work full time. And, you know, when I get home and, you know, the house is still a mess, you know, I've got, you know, basically a part-time job just cleaning up after everybody.
Hmm.
So she has enough time and energy to give to other people out in the real world, and then she comes home and relies on you to kind of pick up the slack.
Yeah, it's just, I just don't know what to do. I'm kind of at my wit's end.
Yeah, and I can feel that. So hang on a second. I want to get people's thoughts on this because I'm going to assume that most of us have been through this.
Sometimes you're both on board. Somebody feels like maybe they're doing more, so they pull back a little bit to show the other person, hey, look at all that I'm doing. You need to start picking up the slack as well. Jen had actually texted in while Sean was talking. She says that she sounds like she's so overwhelmed that she's shutting down. Sean shouldn't make her feel bad until they figure out if it's her mental health or not, which depression could be it.
How do you, is this for a professional? Like, I mean, as a husband, can you really even, besides just keep doing what you're doing, is there something you can do, or does this have the flag of, like, you need to see somebody?
Yeah, and there's no shame in that game. If you say, listen, I'm noticing that you're not as active in the household as you used to be, is there a reason if she starts to say, you know, I'm not feeling the way I've always felt, like I feel really depressed, then you support her on that journey.
I'm willing to bet more than a few of our listeners have gone through something like this.
Can you help me? Can you help me? Can you help me?
Everybody. First off, off, thanks for all the texts. I appreciate it. That's what I've always loved about our audience is when they see something, they're willing to help. And if you missed our conversation with Sean a couple of seconds ago, to nutshell it.
But now it's just kind of, it's just me doing everything. Like all the chores, cooking, all that stuff.
So basically you said, you know, the beginning of their marriage, they've been married 8 years. They have three kids. He and his wife would kind of split all the chores. And now she's really just kind of throwing her hands up and not doing anything. So he's like, how do I approach this? It's exhausting.
Yeah, I mean, you don't want to make them feel like a pile, like you're not doing anything, but there's a way to bring it up. Like, we need to start making each other feel like things are even around here, which is a relationship. So,
morning, Brady. How you feeling?
Good.
Good. Us too. Thanks for asking. What would you say here to Sean? We got any advice?
Yeah, I've been on that receiving end with my fiance of having that conversation, and it's hard, but I feel like you have to have those tough conversations, and she may be a certain way at first, which I was, because, you know, you're defensive, but it's in all helping you, and it's helping your family and your kids and everything.
Maybe we can get inside her psyche by getting inside of yours. What was your reason for not pulling your weight around the house? What did he bring up?
Depression and anxiety. So okay. I ended up going in, and it was first after I had my first kid. So I had postpartum depression.
Yeah.
And I had that fear that I would go through that. So even before, we both said to each other, like, if you notice anything, please, like, point it out to me, because I want to get help, like, right away before it gets past the point and gets really worse.
Yeah. How did that conversation go? Can I ask real quick? How did he bring it up to you?
It was hard because it was awkward.
Okay.
And he's like, hey, I've just noticed, you know, some different things with you. And I was like, well, what do you mean? And that's when he said, like, you're just shutting down a lot. You don't seem like as wanting to play with our kid as much.
Yeah.
And I was more focused on doing the house cleaning and then not spending time with them.
Uh-huh.
So it was a little flipped, but it really opened my eyes. And I broke down, but it needed to be had. And then he just helped me, you know, get an appointment, go in.
That's amazing.
Yeah. That's a good dude you got there.
Yeah. Some guys are like, come on, you had this baby you wanted forever. Why can't you just like be a mom? And it's like, listen, there's so much more to it. You know, it's like the hormones and stuff that is completely out of your control.
You sound like you're doing well right now. How long ago was this?
This was 4 years ago.
All right. Things are good.
We've been for 10. Yeah. Yep. And I just moved and I work remote. So I kind of went through all of it again where I worked from home, and he kind of pointed it out again. He's like, you need to get out of the house. I'm like, yep, nope.
Yeah. And sometimes really it's something that small that can, you know, be a trigger. It can be just something that's good for your mental health.
But so, what a great relationship. Instead of him jetting, just wanting you to be the best version of you, and he wants to stay with you. And just that's what a partnership is. You must keep have each other in check.
You got that sweet stuff, don't you?
Yeah.
Definitely.
You're the best. Hey, thanks for the help. This is good. I felt like when he was talking to us at first that this was kind of beyond like just regular everyday talk. Like this is something that probably a professional should step in with and help.
And not like obviously yes, but like at first it's kind of like you just have to have that alone conversation and just approach it as like you're not trying to like attack her or, you know, just really gentle and like, hey, I've been seeing this and noticing this. Yeah. And then just see if she starts, you know, spilling out.
Yep.
Gotcha. All right. Good looking out. Thanks for all your help, Brittany. We appreciate you. I want you to realize how poor you are right now. Even if you consider yourself to be pretty wealthy, I'm not talking wealthy in love and enriched life. I want you to understand the value of money.
What if someone for a brief moment wasn't thinking about how poor they were? And now you're like, let's go back to it.
Well, I wanted to put this on a level of how wealthy you are compared to Taylor Swift.
Mm-hmm.
Last week, it came out that her net worth is $1.5 billion.
She works hard, though.
Not saying she doesn't. Not saying she's not even deserving of it. I just want you to understand as you go about your daily business, what you think is a significant investment, how little it is to her. So, for example, if you go buy a pair of Lulu leggings, about $100, with her value, that's like 11 cents.
Yeah. She makes a lot per minute.
If you wanted to go out to dinner with your husband and two great friends and talk high-end dinner, like one that's going to be like $700 when you're done with drinks,
oh my God,
and your seven courses. We most of us have one of those, maybe two of them a life.
Yeah.
You know, for us, it's when we go to awards banquets and we don't get awards.
Yes. Those are fun.
That's like 81 cents to her.
Yeah.
That's less than a dollar. We're going to go out for a $700 meal. And for her, that's like giving them a dollar.
I know. You know, the part that I don't want to know when I die, but I do want to know how long I have to enjoy the money that I'm saving for. Because Derek and I really live like we are poor. We put a lot into 401ks, retirement.
Which is going to be a damn shame if you kick it at 55.
I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, what if we should just like grab... You're like 10K out and go for like one of those epic vacations that you talk about for the rest of your life.
For most of us, if we go buy a new iPhone, it's like $1,200. For her, that's less than $2.
I know.
Now, here's the one that really put it into perspective for me. If you or I were like, yep, we're going for it. We're going to buy our dream car. Let's say high-end Porsche, Tesla Cybertruck. For her... That's $100.
I know.
To buy a $100,000 vehicle, it's like her having $100 come out of her
really
wallet.
That's a really good spot to be in life. Like, you don't have to be at Taylor Swift wealth level, but to have financial security and not have to think about certain expenditures, like, that's a really good feeling. And it's very easy to do it if you just buckle down. A lot of people are like, no, it's not easy. Yes, it is. Like, look at everything that you spend your money on. You could totally make it happen.